Yeah. Hi, I'm B. Pagelsminer, the founder of Divergent Ventures, a venture firm that invests in middle America. Welcome to my page. So the topic of the week this week is actually surrounding failure, right? So from a VC perspective, I think it's just very normal for people to spend a lot more time on the successes, the unicorns, the companies that, you know, are those rocket ships that, you know, take a fund straight to that 70 or 100x return. But I think it's very important to understand when a company has failed or when an investment has failed and kind of dive into a little bit of the why. So to this week, it's about Haus, so H-A-U-S. So this is, it's called itself an aperitif company. So I think I should define aperitif because to be truthful, I thought it was like, I'm from Mississippi originally. Like I said, you know, we drink moonshine down there and it's delicious. So, you know, when I looked up aperitif, I was like, this is kind of strange, but I think of it as like a cousin of seltzer, right? So it's something that's kind of like light, that's airy, that, you know, would be easy to drink, I guess, you know, as you're hanging out with your buds, you know, I don't know, own a yacht, I don't know. But anyway, I'm just joking. You can drink an aperitif wherever you would like. But what's really interesting about them is that they had raised $17 million on SAFE. So I previously defined a SAFE. So this is just it's a mechanism for a VC firm or any type of investor to invest into a particular company very quickly without a lot of the same paperwork or same, you know, lift as you would have on some other types of investments. And then also it's based on, you know, the potential value of the company. So for instance, they don't have to have a specific round, you know, they don't have to have a, you know, a seed round or series A or series B. You can do a SAFE at any time and say, this will be based on this valuation at this later time, right? So it's a good way for like a VC to get in there and get a lot of value and negotiate even more value. So it's like, if this works out like it's supposed to work out, maybe this little investment I made over here that's like $500,000 could actually be worth, you know, 10 or 20 or 50. I mean, like exorbitantly large numbers later. And so that's why people like to use SAFEs. So there's nothing against SAFEs. And so my mention of that doesn't indicate that that would be a sign that this deal wouldn't go well, because I've done many SAFEs. Many other VCs have done many SAFEs. The thing that's interesting about them is that they were trying to raise a $10 million Series A, which is definitely very in line for kind of where you would expect that company who's raised that kind of funding around it to be able to kind of accomplish for their Series A. What's really interesting about this and really makes me bring up a few other topics, right? Because like when I think about these kind of specialty goods, because this feels very specialty, right? Like many of us could go and we could go grab our whiskey. For me, it's Maker's Mark, you know, or actually Blanton's if I'm feeling really sassy. But you know, it's, you know, you could go grab that beverage and you'd be fine. You can go to your local store and you can go be fine. You could go to a grocery store and you could be fine. If you're in some cities, you can go to a Walgreens and you can go get any of these types of beverages and it's no big deal, right? And so really when I think about these types of beverages, these are getting into very sophisticated, outside of the norm, so they feel like there's something extra outside of the norm for people. So it feels like it starts getting to those terminologies of a luxury or something that is not necessarily something that they need. And so instantly start to think, well, is this, you know, not going to hit product market fit, right? Because if you think about what product market fit is when users use a product in explosive and destructive ways. And so what that means is that it's when you absolutely cannot keep the shelves stocked with those particular products, right? Like you know, like a great example is air fryers, right? When air fryers first came out, they're like, you couldn't even find an air fryer. Same thing with Instant Pot. Like it was just so popular, especially during COVID, that they could not keep them stocked. However, you know, they were a fad. Just kind of simply like Haus was, or how Blue Apron or HelloFresh all are, right? Because ultimately you can just go to your local store and find a different option, right? And so whenever you're dealing with these types of products or whenever you're thinking about these types of models, one of the ways that I think about it from a investor perspective is, okay, is this a luxury product, right? And again, coming from my background where I'm from in America, where I've lived, you know, I know that I have friends, family, cousins, you know, all these people who, if they had a choice between trying a new brand that they don't know of something and just going to get their normal every single day $2 chuck from Trader Joe's wine, they're probably gonna do it. And it's because it's a trusted product. They know exactly what the intrinsic value is. And so in order to move them away from that particular product, you have to be so delightfully different or provide so much more value than what they've typically had that they will then trust your brand and try your brand. And the simple fact is it's not something that's gonna happen with goods in that particular category, right? Now, if you were a new car dealer, car, for instance, like with Tesla. Tesla was completely new. It had so much differentiation from other cars on the market. And that's why they could charge a premium price for it. They could not deliver it for many, many years, even though they told you they were gonna deliver it to you. And people would still wait, because there was nothing else like it, right? And now they have the same problem that any other company has. Once other people enter into that market and can do the same thing, what is your value differentiator, right? I mean, insane mode is great, and the fact that you can, you know, make funny things happen with the sound of your car is great, but it also has, you know, a really high price tag, and is it worth it to you? And so, you know, it's not surprising to me like that a Haus didn't do well, just like it's not surprising that Blue Apron or Hello Chef does middling or so many other services. In fact, many of the ones that you actually see do well in this category are usually more aligned to very specific needs and desires. So for instance, my family, we use Sarabelli for our son. So Sarabelli is his absolute favorite pouch. And so every single solitary time, you could put all different types of food in front of him. If you put a Sarabelli pouch in front of him, he's gonna grab that up and he's gonna eat that down, right? And so that's a great example of a product that there's no need for me to move away from it. I know it's consistent, it's within a certain value. Obviously, as he gets older and he eats different types of food, that's the only reason I would move away from it. No, there's services like Smoothie Box that only do smoothies. There's services like Athletic Greens that only do green drinks and things like that. And so there's something to this. There's something to this idea that like you have to have something that's so specifically niche that there's nothing else that can come into the market that can move someone away from what you're building. And so a bespoke aperitif, I think about hard seltzer. I mean, there's truly lemonade now. There's simply lemonade, all this type of stuff that you can just go out there, you can get that's essentially the same thing. And because they're mass, you know, produced by a large conglomerate, they can do it far cheaper, far faster, and they can also put a Super Bowl ad up there. So in summary, I guess, you know, it really comes down as an investor, you're trying to figure out, is this a fad? Right? You know, Warren Buffett said, you know, lots of fads do well in the short term, but they don't do well in the long term. It's why oil has been the only consistent, you know, product or companies that have been the top 20 largest companies in the United States for the past 50 years, because it's the one thing that every single person in America relies on to some extent. So that's what you're looking for, right? You're looking for people, ideas, companies that feel like that they feel so timeless that 50 years from now people will still be talking about it. And that's how you choose an investment, and that's why Haus failed. Thank you for coming to my page today. If you liked what you saw, feel free to like, subscribe, or click the notification bell to get my content every day.